too much polite on stage.
Yeah, right? Like,
we've got 7 minutes, kitten. 7 minutes.
Vamp?
I see the reference. Is there a reference to something?
No. That means fill time.
Oh, that's the first time I've heard that. Sorry, this is all new to me.
I'm old school theater. Vamping means kill time, tap dance in front of the audience.
Yeah, no, like, ooh, I've never heard that in theater before.
Tell us about your
interests. My face?
My flight.
The flight? Well, I'm a little baby. I'm not used to flying, so whenever there's turbulence, I'm just like... And I'm sure Aaron here is just a pro at flying. And just like super hyper turbulence, like, whatever, I'm going to take a nap.
I'm kind of badass when it comes to that. I do take a nap. I find it very soothing. I'm like, oh, it's wrecking me to sleep.
Like, I hear the airflow of the plane, and I hear like a slight alteration in the sound, just like, is the plane going to crash?
This is, people have to give you like something to sleep with? Like, before, you take like one of those sedatives before you get on the airplane?
No, I just go to the airport bar and have a few drinks.
Oh, that'll work. That's a good one, right?
And thankfully, I have my 3DS here, so I can play my Super Smash Brothers and have Mario beat up everyone and try to... Everyone. Even that guy.
You're definitely going to beat me up. I just, like, I thought you played with the stylus.
He has the best 3DS, just for the record.
Yo,
his 3DS beats your 3DS.
It's because, like, whenever I'm playing, I can just run the whole cast.
You made it!
Hello!
I got so lost.
We waited for you. We haven't started yet. We're just killing time. Vamping.
Term I can't believe I just learned today.
Oh, that is chicken.
I am
a young chicken.
I am just going to
just straight out the egg.
It's true.
Yeah.
I'm just like, I'm an actor. Death of a salesman. There you go. Getting heavy on you.
Good. Theater references. We're entertaining ourselves now.
Real though, you gotta do something to pass the time. Hey, actors do that all the time.
Okay.
A little bit.
Challenge you.
We get from watching.
Can I challenge you?
On TV?
Yeah, or anything. Whatever. You can watch.
I just finished Peaky Blinders. That was amazing.
Peaky Blinders, what is
there was that original Netflix series, and there's two seasons out, and I like anything that comes from England, and it's just, it's like Sopranos in England, 1800s.
Oh,
no, 1900s. 1900s.
Okay.
1920s. I can't believe I said 1920s.
Right after World War I.
Wrong costume.
Yeah, yeah. It's a good show.
I'm big time anime man. I've been watching a lot of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. Season 2, opening. Come on, guys, you're spoiling everything in that opening, but also, JoJo's been out for, like, how many years? 30 years already?
Roughly.
Yeah, most definitely at this point, starting in the 80s, 2015, like, Araki, the man discovered the Fountain of Youth. He's literally, you look at pictures of him, just like, you never age.
Like, Jennifer Lopez?
Basically, but more extreme. Just
like, I don't think she's a human. I think she might be an alien, and she doesn't.
You should call her up and ask her. Be like, yo, girl,
I'm
age.
Going to. I'm like, give me a second.
I bet she's on white page. Look her up.
Just joking. I don't know her.
But hey, you cook one of these days. Hey, Jennifer. Oh, what's up? That easy.
Chris will be asking her for a date. I wonder if she would date younger men after that movie. I would think that might be a turn off. What are you guys watching?
Korra.
Korra.
Oh, the commentaries on the Toriko.
That was such a good show.
Toriko.
I really do. Which
hey.
One? What are you watching?
Toriko.
Toriko. Over here. Anyone?
Sherlock.
Sherlock. Always.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Parasite.
Nobody else is watching anything.
Arrow.
Arrow.
Arrow. Okay.
Well, what did you say?
Parasite.
Parasite?
Parasite, yes!
Yes. That's awesome.
Big fan of.
What are you watching back there? What are you watching on TV right now? Sailor Moon. Are you watching the redub? Because I'm a lot of the evil girls in the redub. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
You gotta promote the work, right? In the upcoming episodes, if it's a bad girl,
girl, it could be me. Just saying.
Wasn't one of the villains, like, that, like, a villain of the week in that show was like, I've got tennis ball powers.
I think there was, yeah.
Something like
I know I was one of the villains that, was the principal of a princess school. Teaching the girls how to be ladies.
Oh.
That one.
Yeah.
And then another villain with the clock. And then a couple more that are coming out. But I don't... If it's already, I don't even know, am I allowed to talk about it? If it's a redub, like, the episodes are out there.
Spoilers.
Like, is it really a fresh spoiler? Right, like, I don't even know. I don't want to get in trouble. Oh, we haven't started. We've been waiting for you.
Yeah,
we got 1 whole minute. No pressure. I love your arm. What is, everyone in the room is joking. Fantastic. We're good.
We're good.
We haven't even started. We're just vamping.
Everything's good.
Word of the day.
Word of the day.
Word of the day.
Yeah. He was adorable. My favorite part of the cosplay. You guys are adorable. I had to squeeze you. If it wasn't creepy.
Have you?
Oh, it's 4:30.
4:30? Do we?
Official.
Official?
We should have an opening.
What kind of opening should we
musical,
do?
Do a musical one.
Oh, welcome to the voice acting Q&A. I've never taken musical theater before.
We have Chris Cabrero.
And Erin Fitzgerald.
Well, I'm going to go for that. What is that? The
EGAT?
EGAT. Thank
you. Yeah, there you go.
We've all got one of those in here.
Fantastic. So, I've had this sitting in front of me. I've been holding it for probably 15 minutes now. This is pulled pork. Is it, Aunt Alexander? Where are you?
Yeah, it's a barbecue pork sandwich.
Alexander brought me a barbecue pork sandwich. For real, though. He brought it to me because he knows Chie says... What does Chie say?
Daddy's more meat! So I'm totally gonna eat this right now, and it might be the messiest panel I ever did. This is a photo op, I believe is what they call it. Photo op. Chie Jackets. Eating meat and Chie Jackets.
So you're just a little preview of the Chie spin-off series? Chie Eats Meat? Wait, that sounded a lot worse than I
intended. Oh my god, this is really good. Dude, this is fantastic. Where'd you get them?
There was a convenient little booth in the booth.
Convenient little booth sells good meat.
I'm near the booth looking for meat. I was told I could find some meat here.
There you go. Perfect.
Just come to the convenient booth. That's called convenient.
What is the title of this panel so we know what we're supposed to be talking about?
Voice acting.
Oh, okay, that's pretty good.
Wait, voice acting? Who does that?
I like Q&A's. How do you like to do? Is there anything you want to share? But I love to hear from you guys, because the fact that you even showed up to listen to us talk is kind of amazing to me. And apparently watch me eat.
I've hardly done a Q&A, so I guess I'll do an introduction since I'm newer to the voice acting scene.
He's a baby.
I am just a pure babe to this. My name's Chris Guerrero. I do a lot of stuff at Funimation Entertainment.
What do you mean?
My most recent projects, I'll descend. I was in One Piece. I voiced a villain called Gecko Moria. And he does this ridiculous laugh that's just... But after, like, doing that for 2 hours, you're just like... I also voiced a character in a fairy tale called by the name of Ichiya Vanilla Kotobuki. Yeah. And he's this very short, stout man with this hyper detailed, handsome face that he thinks he's a big playboy.
Typecasting.
He thinks he's a playboy, but he's just a goofy man, and he's just like, smell my parfum. And one of my other most notable roles. basically did the Ichigo voice, but it was just like a little more outrageous because it is a show all about food. Like takoyaki trees, rocks that spawn like sushi, just weird stuff, and the tagline is just like,
this is the gourmet age when the world's manliest heroes quest for culinary delights.
And if you are on the internet, you might have heard me. And does anybody know what Team Four Star is? Yeah. And their little series. Yeah, right? The internet age, the millennials. I have voiced Dr. Gero. And in the Helsing of Bridge series, I do the voice of Enrico Maxwell. So that's my introduction.
All right. Give me a second. This was really good, for real, though. I really can't thank you for that. I realized I didn't eat lunch. Thank goodness for peanut sandwiches.
That's first speech yet.
Thank you for your patience.
My name is Erin Fitzgerald. I have been a voice actor for coming on 20 years. I started my career in a show on a brand new channel in 2000, 1999, 88 for me, on Cartoon Network. That was a new channel at the time. And I was on a show called Edit and Eddie.
I
That's my story
right there.
Nobody ever knows.
Wait, you've been to a con where people don't know Edit?
No, I do, but nobody knows it's me that I thought would have done it. Because I don't like that moment is played. Who knows who I play? Anybody in this room know who I play?
No.
The Kankers.
I play one of the Kankers. I play May Kanker. I like boys. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to kiss your face. And I play one other character. Can anybody guess?
Naz.
Yes.
Naz. What's with the style and clothes, Eddie? It's customer appreciation day at the candy store, and you're giving away jawbreakers for free.
That was fun. So I was on a show called Ed and Eddie, which led to a lot of cartoons. I actually started in cartoons specifically because there were no voices in video games. But now that I'm, pardon me, it's a good sandwich. Now that I'm really established in both cartoons and video games, actually my very first anime was back then. I played Kodachi on Ranma One Half, way back when, and I was on a series called Saber Marionette J. I played Cherry and Luke's for a period of time, and then I moved to Los Angeles and I lost all my jobs in Canada. But I moved to LA, I got like tons of work, and I play eight characters on Bleach. I play Gurren on Naruto Shippuden. I did actually pull up my website because it's so much easier.
I just have so many characters. Let me break up the resume.
20 years.
Yeah, 20, that is
that's
a lot
all
to remember.
It is. It's 20 years. So I'm going to quit. Oh, I'm on a show called, you guys probably know what, Monster High and Ever After High.
You got me started on those shows.
Dude. You're amazing. So, I'm in those shows. I anime called Beat 'em on Crossfire that played on WB. It's a little kid one, super cute. Kei, Kakashi, Knights of Sidonia, Naruto Shippuden, Persona 4 the Animation. Pokemon Origins, Sailor Moon, the redub, Zetman, and I think there's some stuff that's still coming out, but for the games. Are you ready? I'm going to do my best. The Dot Hack GU series, Bravely Default, Blaze Blue, Kakarin, Citizens of Earth, Conception 2, Cross Edge, Danganronpa, Dead or Alive, Ultimate, Disgaea, Bunch of Disgaea, Dragon's Crown, Dragon's Dogma, Dynasty Warriors, Elder Scrolls Online, Eternal Sonata, Etrian Odyssey Untold, EverQuest 2, Final Fantasy 13, yes! Part 2, 13 Part 3, 14, Fire Emblem Awakening, Hyperdimension Neptunia, tons of games for them, Kingdoms of Amalur Reckoning, Last of Us, League of Legends, Lightning Returns, I already said that one, Monkey Quest, Mugen Souls, Persona 4 everything! Persona 2, Ragnarok, Rune Factory, Saints Row, tons of Saints Row, Shin Megami Tensei, bunch of Shin Megami Tensei, Silent Hill, Book of Memory, Sonic Boom, Rise of Lyric, I apologize, but it was... You can't tell when you're recording. Skullgirls, Tales of the Abyss, Tales of Xillia 2, The Talos Principle, which just came out. It's a puzzle game. It's amazing. It's amazing. So there's a plug for those guys. World of Warcraft, Burning Crusade. More importantly, World of Warcraft, Warlords of Draenor. I am Yurel. Zero Escape, Virtue's Last Reward, and that's kind of like, I think that's the juicy bits. Okay, are we good?
So as you can tell, we have the grand wise sensei here, and a pupil right here.
Notice me, senpai.
I love that you have a your hand up for a question, so let's rock and roll.
So for questions, we have a mic here. For
oh, there's a mic.
I don't think I need one. I'm good.
Okay.
Who are you in Danganronpa?
I am four of Junko's personalities, and I play Genocide Jack. Not Tuca, Genocide Jack. Tuca is played by, oh well, you came to this panel, word. Amanda C. Miller is my cohort in those games. Not in the anime series, in the games only.
You, there. Yeah.
Who are you in The Last of Us?
All of the female infected.
Okay.
Oh, damn.
That was actually kind of an amazing session. You're never allowed to play that game, by the way. It is a zombie game, and it scared the pants off of me recording it. Oh. And I was the zombie lady. I don't like that game. And I'm in it, and they paid me a lot of money. It was so scary. They literally, this is a trip. You'll enjoy this. I had a microphone cap that I wore on my head, so it freed up my body. So I had the whole room, and they would literally, because when you're an actor, you pretend to be the character. So they had me in different stages of infection, imagining myself with these, and the thing that really got to me was that they kept saying that you're aware of what's happening to you the whole time. So imagine you're turning into an infected, and you're consciously aware of what's happening. And so that just took me to a very dark place. And I remember, we call them throat ripping sessions. I would book it on a Friday. I wouldn't have a voice for 2 days afterwards. Because they, you know, the deal of the game is that you want to get rid of the infected. So I had to die in a myriad of fashions. And the worst would be the on fire death. Because how many people have played a game where the character is supposedly on fire and you hear, fire, it burns! And you're like, really? Seriously? So I take that job very seriously. So I literally, because I could, got down on my knees in the booth, would be screaming all the way backwards, screaming and screaming and screaming on fire to the point of nausea and practically passing out. So that game, even just hearing that music makes me remember that.
Trigger.
It's horrifying to just play a victim that is conscious of your own infection. Oh
right?
My God.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Jeez,
they had me sitting in the room and they're like, now you're, and they would just say scenarios. So they'd be talking in my ear while I'd be like, okay, now you're in a room and you've just snapped, you've lost it, and you're petting a dead cat, and you're singing a lullaby. I'm like, oh. I was so grateful to have 2 days of recovery after those sessions. Like, I
oh, the darkness of humanity.
Right? What we do is weird. Mm-hmm. That was my job. That was a good question. That was probably more than you expected.
That was good. That was perfect. Thank you. Okay. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. You get to pick. I like it when you pick.
Does anyone have any questions? Any hands? Any curious minds? Oh, hey, that guy. What do you got?
Well, first off, I have a question for both of you. I got Aaron. Thank you for the exclusive of letting us know you're citizens of Earth. This is the first voice act confirmed.
No, they put it on Twitter.
What? What is this website? I've never heard of this. Who do you play?
The beekeeper.
All right.
Bees!
Is that your line?
such a quick little session. I remember it being super cute, and I think I play a bunch more too, but they only announced the beekeeper, so.
Yep.
Just announced the beekeeper.
My question for both of you is, what is, when you guys were younger, what was the job you guys really, really wanted to get in, like, the realm of voice? Like, say you go back in time, like, when you were younger.
You're
like,
funny.
Why?
So when I was a kid, there was no such thing as a job like voice acting.
Well, like, there was, but it was for things you wouldn't want to be a part of, but, like...
No, we just didn't know about it. I watched Saturday morning cartoons, but nobody knew who the actors were, because there was no internet or anything like that.
You just brought the intern for everything.
We didn't know. I just thought that, you know, Papa Smurf was Papa Smurf, and Gem and the Holograms was Gem, and, like, those characters were real to me until I was mid-20, and I was in a session doing background voices for Outer Limits, a sci-fi series. And Michael Dobson turned to me and said, "Why aren't you doing cartoon voices?" And I said, "What?" It didn't even occur to me that those were actors playing those characters, because cartoons were really real for me. Because that's how when I grew up, cartoons were really real, because we didn't know who the actors were. My people. We didn't know. Like, this is a brand new thing. I knew at the age of 3 I was going to be a professional actor. No question. I didn't know it would end up.
Did something inspire you? Whatever.
I knew, I just knew. I came into this universe knowing what I was going to do. And I walked away from it twice, just in case, because I keep thinking, I can't possibly be of use to the universe doing this job. I mean, I need to be of service elsewhere. And I would seek out other jobs, and then this job would always come back to me, so I know I'm doing the right thing.
For me, personally, we didn't start really at a young age. It kind of spawned in middle school when I started to get more into the theater scene, because as a young boy, 90s, the internet was a rising thing, and early 2000s, I'm just like, all these online communities, let me check them out. And it's a really dorky story. There's a board where it's like, the Ninja Clan, we're like this RP with ninjas. And we kind of did that, wrote our own original stories about ninjas and stuff like that. And eventually we got our own little forum where we kind of did continued our RP stuff. And that was at my time kind of getting to theater, learning more about it. And there was a guy on the forum that was like, "Hey, so I learned how to do spriting, and I thought it would be really cool to, like, animate our RP adventures. And if you guys are interested, I would like some voice acting." I'm just like... Voice acting? What's this all about? Because I was like...
Theater boy.
I was just like,
he's
huh?
My people.
There, I can voice act? Wait, I'm theater. I'm doing theater. I can do this. So I go out to Best Buy, buy like a really shitty USB Logitech mic, and I'm just like, I'm only like 14, 13, just like, "Watch out, I'll get you, ninja guy." Something like that. Back in the day, like, also, I had a really bad lisp back in the day, which I kind of learned how to get rid of by watching how people talked and where they placed their tongue. So...
That's a real theater guy.
So
I really, really like what you're just sharing right now, because it's really important to know that there's a new trend of calling it voice acting. It's not voice acting. It really isn't. There's no such thing as voice acting. Because if you're a voice actor, you can't compete with the top people in the universe that do this for a living. You have to be an actor, specifically a character actor. And a character actor is best trained through the theater, whether it's through musical theater, regular theater. Improv comedy is a great place because you work on characters in comedy, the comedy world. Those make the best, what is now dubbed, voice actors. But we're really just character actors. And I find that... can always tell. You can tell the difference between somebody who has a theater background and somebody who doesn't, in terms of the weight and the depth of their performance. Somebody who's coming at it strictly from voice can only go, "It's always the exact same read every single time. They don't ever have any kind of range." And somebody who has exactly the same voice, but they do the same thing every time, and then all of a sudden you're crying and you don't know why. You know what I mean? Yeah. You guys know what I'm talking about. Love it! Jacket! Walk on in, come to the front! Just saying, now get something pretty to look at.
But,
come on!
My story just kind of like, basically what really drove me to it was, I was in my theater classroom in high school, and I said to my friend, "You know what, I'd be really interested in doing voice acting." He kind of gives me a funny look and be like, "Dude, you can never be a voice actor." I just looked at him. It's like, Is that so? So kind of like all that was me kind of getting into voice acting and getting where I am was kind of like a major F you to that guy. So sometimes your motivations can be fueled by many a thing.
Mm-hmm. Love the Chia shirt.
Today. And oh. But
but I hope those answered your question. Any other questions around here? Hey! Yeah?
Yeah, I have two questions for Aaron.
Wait a moment, sir. Wait
Ladies
a moment.
First. Ladies first. What are your times for our autographs today and tomorrow?
We are going to do autographs right after this.
Okay, after this?
Someplace. So wherever the Japanese artists are right now, we're gonna take over that table, and we're gonna.
And what about tomorrow?
Tomorrow at 1:30.
Okay. And second one is a line request. In Chia's voice, can you say "Trial of the Dragon"? Hold on, I need to get ready.
If you want to record this, take. She's getting her. Okay.
Trial of the Dragon. Don't think, feel. Yosuke, you broke my DVD!
Sorry, I kind of messed up. Sorry, I kind of messed up with my recording.
Oh, oh.
Sorry.
Redo.
Redo. Sorry.
Don't forget to call him a tool.
I think you could really hype up Trial of the Dragon because you're really mad at Yosuke. What was his name?
Yosuke.
Yosuke. It'd be like Trial of the Dragon kicking the balls.
Trial of the Dragon! You gotta eat more meat! Yosuke, you broke my DVD!
I don't know what to call you. Oh no!
Awesome, good job.
Alright, next question. We're doing Q&A. Oh.
Yeah, this eager man over there. What are your questions? Also, if you feel like you can't project, we have a lovely microphone.
Oh, there is
in the
a
middle.
Microphone for anybody who would like to also be in a mic.
So, I saw in the description that you did the voice of the commander in Dust Elysian Tale.
Yes.
I played that game this past year. Was there anything in particular that drew you to that particular game?
Like, drew me to? Yeah, work, basically. Yeah, money. I had the a dear friend of mine, Devin Math, who does a lot of fantastic voice director, does a lot of Canadian shows, too.
Yeah.
And he had contacted me. There was a many rounds of auditions for the video game, and eventually it was like, hey, I think you'd be really great for the commander. And it was just like about an hour session, and here he goes, like, all right, I'll pay PayPal you money in a week.
These go by really quickly.
It's
video
true.
Games are super in and out. If we have the cherry on a Sunday, that took forever to build.
Is that so?
Yes.
Because you guys have, like, the experience of just playing it upon hours and hours and replaying it, and for us it's just, like, maybe a few hours of performing.
Yeah, it's really the animators and the programmers and the writers that, you know, they put in so much blood, sweat, and tears for every game that's created that makes it out. It's kind of amazing. And then if that company doesn't go under and they get to make another one, it's kind of epic. So that's why I'm very, very loyal to gamer fans, because to be able to do what I do for a living with games, it's a very volatile arena.
Believe me, I know.
Yeah.
Questions? I've done two. Why don't you pick some?
I was doing backseat driving with the King.
Oh,
no worries. A little bit.
Oh, there's so many.
That man with the proud beard and the Heineken shirt, I believe.
If we can't hear you, you're using the mic. We're just saying.
Aaron, could you talk about what it was like to do another take on GA's?
Oh, so it's the original Persona 4, Chie was played by an actress named Tracy Rooney, and it was kind of amazing how I got that job. She, for some reason, Tracy wasn't able to come back to do Chie, so they needed to recast her, and they wanted to make her a little bit younger anyway for the new games. So the voice director and casting person, Valerie Arum with PCB Productions, turned to you and you who directs all the, he turned to him and said, I know Chie. And I didn't audition. I literally got called for the job. Just like, just show up. You don't worry. And so I showed up. I walked into the booth, and for the first 10 minutes, and that happens to me on occasion, and that's kind of an amazing experience when they just call you, and they know you, and they know your range, and they know what you can do, and it's called finding the voice in the first 10 minutes. That's the technical term, but really it's finding the character. So they give me a character breakdown of who the individual is, and they give me a lot of scenarios. Like, really good writers will tell me lots of backstory so that I can really get into the body of the character. So as he's... You is breaking down Chie, I start giggling because everything is hitting my sweet spot. Because my boyfriend, for anybody who doesn't know, he runs a website called Kung Fu Movie Madness, and at my house, we watch a tremendous amount of classic Kung Fu movies, like a serious amount. And if anybody broke one of his classic Kung Fu DVDs, there would be heck to pay. So I was so floored because I feel like I've been prepping this for the last 7 years. and just who she was, the way she's kind of like a giving soul where she's always protecting her. She wants to protect her friends. She's got a little tough edge to her. I relate to that a little bit. So I immediately went into that. All right, what are we gonna do? I don't know. What do you think? And there's mannerisms that she has that are me, that are just me. Like, I can't imitate them because it's part of who I am, and you might hear it as I'm just talking stuff that comes out, like, oh, that's very Chia. Yeah. But there were moments in those recording sessions where we kept trying to slip in as many Bruce Lee references as possible without making it obvious and getting sued. And there would be many sessions where I literally would call my boyfriend and say, can we get away with this? Because he knows everything. He's like, we want to do a call out for... there's a bunch of her fight calls that we wanted to make in reference to Bruce Lee movies, but he was like, no, you can't use those two words together, it'll get you in trouble, but you could do this. And he would give us so my boyfriend kind of helped, right? With anything that's Bruce Lee mentioned, is he gets a little bit of side credit for that. So it was super fun. I obviously love Chie. Like, I love Chie. But I didn't know if anybody else would love her. I expected a lot of people to be really true to the original actress, and I expected a lot of hate. I really did. And the fact that I didn't get a lot of hate, like, there would be people who say that they prefer Tracy, but they were never mean about it, and that I respect, you know? Stay true to the original. I totally respect that. So the fact that she just has gotten as much love as I feel for her from the audience is so cool. It's just so cool. So thank you.
Any questions? Oh, I remember the meat men. The original meat men here.
Thank you for my meat. Part of you came in late. Alexander gave me a pulled pork meat sandwich that I just ate during the panel.
So I have a couple of questions. The first one is, and it's the most important to me, is what are... You already kind of talked about it, but can you go in more depth on the road to becoming a voice actor or being in the business?
It's like, for each person, it's always kind of different. You'll always get a different kind of story. For me, personally, like, I was just very involved in theater, and I, over the years, was just being very involved doing a lot of indie projects online because, thank God, this modern age... a lot of people can be a voice actor if they have the right tools and the right setup and make it in your closet. I have my own little setup in my closet, and I've gotten enough like professional paying gigs online. I did some TV stuff around the Dallas area, you know, kind of like a guy who's like, watch out. And that's me for a second in the background. And of course, theater shows, and I just sent my resume to Funimation because you can send, just say, hey, you can send a resume to us, and we might be added to an open call. And I sent it in. Probably 8 months later, I got like an email from them saying, hey, we're doing auditions for this show. Why don't you come in? I went in, auditioned, didn't get anything that time. Second time, they called me in like a month later. It's like, we're doing the theater show. Come in. And that was Toriko, and I got the narrator for that, which was really cool because shonens, thankfully, are
50-100 episodes long, so I had a good constant paycheck for a while. So that was my story of how I got into voice acting.
What I really like about what he's sharing is the real secret to getting into anything you want to do in life. This is not even specific to voice acting. To anything that you want to do, that you're passionate about, that you love, the real secret is the hours. It's putting in the hours towards it. It's a 1,000-hour theory. So I started acting at 3, doing characters in theater, and so by the time I got to university, I'd already had thousands and thousands of hours put into the craft that I was interested in studying. Then in university, I put in thousands and thousands and thousands of more hours. So when I finally got behind a microphone, really all I needed to learn was some mic technique, but the characters and the acting chops were really, really, really strong. Strong enough to book me a lead in a cartoon series. You know what I mean? So, and I was technically on the scene a newbie, but I wasn't really new to the craft. I had thousands of hours of practice. So whether you're a chef, you know, somebody who builds costumes for a living, if you're an accountant, if you're anything you want to be a master at, because every single job we do as human beings is creative. Every single job. If we choose to find the creativity in it, because we all have that creativity within us. So you can, if you look deep inside yourself and if you're bored at your job, that means you're not being creative with it. And it's time to look at how you can be creative with it. You can always change things to be so much more fun and so much more juicy if you use your imagination. So putting in those hours is a big deal. Letting yourself be creative with those hours is a big deal. And then you find that it generally just unfolds naturally. There's a momentum that builds up from putting that attention on that thing you love. It just grows like a snowball that starts really little, and those hours just are that snowball getting bigger and bigger and bigger. For example, this is a great actual example. I was at the airport in LAX flying here, and I happened to sit down next to some random dude. Random dude happened to be working on a comic book. He was a comic book writer. This was his first comic book. So the universe plops me next to him, and we start a conversation. And what I do relates to what he does. And I do happen to have a lot of information towards the comic book realm. My cousin, you might know him. He worked with Todd McFarlane for years. His name is Terry Fitzgerald, and he co-created the Spawn series. So he's one of those people in my universe that I listened to his story. So I got to share with this guy all sorts of information that he wouldn't have had any other way, because he's not from LA. He just happened to be there for his day job. But he's working on this comic book. And I loved that. That to me was the reward that comes from putting in hours and hours towards your passion. The reward is that the universe attracts the people that are going to answer questions that you really have been looking for the answers. Did that English work? Almost, but you know what I mean, right?
And as always, never be afraid of failure. You're yes. Going to be bad at something to begin with, because, like she said, you got to put in the hours, because if you're being new, like a lot of, I guess, and kind of like, not so much, well, kind of in the culture, like, we see failure as a bad thing. No, that means you learn from your mistakes. That's how you improve as a person and in your craft. And from failures upon failures upon failures, you learn a little bit more information at that time, and eventually, you're a pro at it.
Man, if you knew how many times I audition a year and don't book it, thousands upon thousands of failures.
You're competing with just so many people, so you know.
But the beautiful thing is, for each time I don't book it, I know I'm one step closer to a booking. So I don't look at it. I don't look at that as a failure. I look like I need to get 100 no's before I get one yes. That's generally in business anywhere. That's what they say. For 100 no's, you get one yes. So I look for those auditions. Let's get those 100 no's. Let's hurry up and get them so I can get to the yes. Let's just pile them up. I love that. That's yeah. Part of the process.
Mm-hmm. That's the thing. And like, you need to be active. You got to keep at it no matter what. Don't get discouraged. Be like, okay, I'll move on to the next thing.
Exactly, because that's the only way you get better. And trust me, some of the people we get to be in the room with would blow your mind.
to see them in the physical doing what they do. Like, when I sit next to Jennifer Hale, my brain wants to melt. She's amazing. What the hours she's put into her craft, she's now the, for anybody who doesn't know, she's the current voice of Cinderella, and she's Femme Shep from the Mass Effect series, and a million other things. She's got the Guinness Book of World Records for female in video games. She's amazing. So that's the competition. So you want to have those hours. You don't want to put out a demo after you've studied it for a year. You want to make sure that when you put out your demo, it's going to have those hours behind it to support your talent, which is probably strong. It just hasn't been practiced enough yet.
And also, having a network of people who also work in that craft is great, especially if you want to be a voice actor, because could you critique this before I actually send it out?
Oh, that's good. Although sometimes that's bad. Because people get jelly if you're really good.
Only if you're really good friends with them.
They'll be like, no, that's bad. You should have said that. That happens. It happens. Actors, vanity, ego.
So, inside or outside of your industry, or current industry, I should say, who is the most famous person either of you have worked with, and what was that experience like?
That's a relative question, because who is most famous to you may not be who is most famous to me.
Well, that's fine. Because I'm...
You go first. Think about it. That's a good question. That's a really good question.
Well, since I'm mostly a Texas boy, I grew up watching a lot of Dragon Ball Z, a lot of Funimation dubs, and, going in there and just casually seeing, like, Mike McFarlane, director of, like, Attack on Titan, voice of Yajirobe, and just a ton of other stuff, and just like, hey, what's up, man? I'm just like... I didn't say that though. I was thinking that in my mind. It's just like, keep professional, Chris. Hey, pleasure to meet you. It's like, we're gonna go record. I'm like, all right.
I'm like, that's a good. Okay, so that's how I'm gonna answer this question. The people I did that over. Last month, I got to do a theater show with Ray Romano. That happened in real life for me. I also got to be, I didn't work with him, but I don't care. I'm counting this. At Dragon Con, I was on a panel in between Bill Farmer, the voice of Goofy, and John Ratzenberger. Who for me is Cliff on Cheers. So I was like, oh my god, this is awesome. I also got to be on a theater show stage with the Kids in the Hall, which blew my mind as a Canadian. That was a huge deal for me. And then one of the coolest things in a cartoon record, I was on a show called Fat Dog Mendoza that aired on Cartoon Network UK, and the woman who played the original voice of Casper the Friendly Ghost walked in. And I also just recently fangirled over Nikki Yang, who plays BMO, because I love BMO. So I didn't know I was going to fangirl over her, but I saw her, and I'm like, oh, look at that, BMO! Yeah, so those are some of my favorites, but there might be other people that have been in the room with me that you might be like, oh my god!
Laura Bailey!
I know that.
Laura Bailey, sorry.
Oh, I'm on everything with Laura. Laura is like, she's a friend of mine.
She's in like everything we geek out over.
Yeah, she's so cute. She's so talented too. She's so cute and talented. I adore her.
Did you work with her on WoW too?
Not next to her, no, but like she's in WoW, I'm in WoW, but I next to her on Monster High, Ever After High, that kind of stuff. Like cartoons we get to record together.
Wow.
Yeah.
Any other questions for us? Yes, the one man in the back.
The one man.
You're alone! Use the mic! For the win!
Yes, the first, you are, you bring in the mic.
You win
the
car!
Teach you mic technique.
A mic technique. Well, I'm starting now.
Let me see.
You're good.
This question is out of voice acting or anything like that. Do you guys ever do podcasting? Internet radio?
Oh, yeah. I'm interviewed on podcasts all the time.
I remember you appear on Gundam.
Yes, probably. I don't do a lot of them.
No.
Okay.
But the biggest question is for you, for both of you guys, is do you like to appear in podcast?
Yes.
I have a podcast. You
always.
Like to appear in my podcast?
Yes, just give us a shoot me a little thing on Twitter and I'm always down for a podcast.
Yeah, same. Just shoot us a message on Twitter and I'll
be
like, yo, what up?
And the second question, just because I know you guys also want to have questions.
Hold them back.
Is any roles from any of the voice actors that you want to do? Like, you get jealous because, Tiffany Grant do this voice acting and I want this role.
That is a great question. I don't normally, but I did a series of auditions before I came here on Thursday, and it was like all these, I got a bunch before I left. It was like 30 characters. Most of them I was like, it'll be cool. Then there was one, that should be mine.
I can't talk
because it's an audition and it hasn't been cast yet, but if I don't get this, I will be crying for a very long time, and I will have a very hard time seeing the person who gets cast at that. Like, it's going to be awkward if I don't get that. It's going to be the only, and I try not to focus on being attached to auditions and to roles, and I try to look at other people's work as an opportunity to learn and get better. So because first of all, as a female in this industry, you know, we get hired 1 to 20 men. So if any of my sisters are working, it's a big deal, and I want to support them and not be a competition to them, because that is a huge deal. Women don't have enough roles in video games or cartoons. I had, in that 30 characters I read for, 3 of them were female characters that they asked men to read for. So that's taking more jobs away. So I'm like, okay, I would not recommend this job for women, because it is a challenge and it can get very competitive, and I choose not to be like that. But every once in a while, there's that one where that little green monster comes out and is like, who do I have to be? Precious! Precious! You know what I mean? And I don't like having that feeling, because I feel like that pushes the job further away, because when you hold on to something tightly, it's very hard to book it. When you kind of let that space between, and that's for anybody trying to apply for any job anywhere. I find the more you try to really want something, the further it runs away from you. But the more you can let that space happen and be like, may the blessings be, que sera, sera. If it's meant to be mine, it will. The odds generally rise if it's meant to be.
As for like roles, that are you in the sense like kind of like a dream role?
More like
if you could take somebody's job.
Yes.
Take somebody's job. Oh, well. I can't really think of that because they're cast for a reason.
It is. That's a great answer.
But I can say like a dream role. Like I would like bless Steam Bloom. I'm a big fan of his, but. I would give anything to be a Starscream. Like, weirdly enough, I'm not really into Transformers, but I love the character. He's just a conniving little creep that I love those characters because they're little piss lords.
That's funny because my favorite are the evil ones too.
They're just
favorite,
so cool.
Oh my goodness, I like to be really.
Any example that the voice, how it's going to be the voice of the Starscream?
Do it.
I serve only you, Lord Megatron.
But soon,
I'll take over the Decepticons and stab you in the back.
What? Nothing! No, I didn't say anything.
Thank you, guys.
Good questions. Yes, Ben Deniman.
Is that Scott Pilgrim?
So awesome.
Yo, coming up to the mic.
I like the preparation. Good technique. Nice hair.
So, from what I understand, this is more of a question towards Aaron. Sorry, Aaron, I still love
you. Yeah, no worries.
And he's super popular. 20 years of voice acting, of course,
everyone's gonna know that.
Now they do.
So, Aaron, from what I understand, you are actually the one who provides the voice talent for a character. Parasol in Skull Rooks, correct?
Take the shot.
All right. So I guess what I'm kind of wondering is, I remember hearing from a specific person that another famous voice actor by the name of Christina B was actually the voice director for that game. I guess what I'm kind of wondering is, how was it like working like under her like direction? And I guess generally speaking, what was it like working with behind the scenes with Skullgirls?
That is a fantastic question. Skullgirls is my favorite all-time project because it is a project of love. Because of the fans, that game would not exist if the fans hadn't all come together and raised $500,000 to keep that game going. So, Parasol fans, you guys come above everybody, sorry. But you own the game. You are the reason I got the job. You know, getting called in, I remember getting the, let me go back to the beginning. I remember getting the sides for this project, and Christina sent an email and apologized. I was like, this is not going to pay normal rate. This is a real, real indie project. But I took one look at Alex Ahad's designs, and I was in love, and I read for every character. I was like, I don't care who I am. I just want in this game. And they gave me Parasol, and I got to go into the session, and there was little Miss Christina V. Her director's hat on for the first time. She was so nervous.
Okay, what we'd like to do,
you know, like that's how she was doing.
Could you do that again, just a little bit more French?
She was so adorable. She was fantastic, by the way. She gave spectacular direction. She knew exactly what, and it was really hard because we weren't doing the story mode. It was mostly a lot of call-outs. So to create a character when all of the dialogue is just like, voila, take the shot, you know, that kind of thing. Like, who is this character? So she did a great job of filling me in on who the character was, what this world was going to be. She did such a spectacular job. It was such a gift of love. And then after we raised all that money, and the fans are so much a part of all of the new content for that game, like Robo Fortune. If it weren't for that fundraiser, we never would have gotten Robo Fortune or the Salty Parasol track that will come out at some point. I promise. It's just, so much is on the table right now, but it's been amazing. So thank you for asking.
Not a problem.
Any other curious minds? Yes, that man.
Question for me?
Yep.
What is your question?
What's it like working with Team 4-Star in comparison to working on Funimation?
Yeah.
Well, I will say, actually, those guys take their stuff very seriously. Usually, Kaiser Neko, Scott, treats it like, you know, like any other kind of recording session, because it's just like, he'll call me on Skype, I'll go in my booth, I'll have my headphones on, he'll be like, hey, you know, a little banter before, like, any regular session, be like, okay, here's the scene, here's all this, and it's pretty cut and dry, actually, so it's just like, alright, he's, like, you better watch out, he's kind of in the air, you're gonna call that out more, you better watch out, could you put more conviction to it, you better watch out, good, good take, we'll keep that, but yeah, no, it's nothing, like, too, goofy or unique, we'll pop jokes here and there, have a little casual convo. I'm not having you be like, can I take a potty break? Excuse me. But they treat it like a true professional project. So that's why the quality has been just so consistently good.
The only difference is that when you're recording a project in your booth at home, you can wear your pajamas. They don't know. They don't know.
Because my booth gets a little hot, so
what
sometimes...
What I just do, I have no airflow. I recorded, Lord of the Rings Online, Riders of Rohan, I got to be Yoen, and I recorded that in my booth at home, and it was a long session, and I was like...
You start to drip in there! I remember one session, because it was a long one, and I'd be like, at the end of it, I was just in my underwear, be like...
I've done that too. It was just so sweaty.
I'm just
so
like, close. It's for the art. It's for the art.
Nobody knows. Well, now you know.
Now you know my darks. It's not even dark secret. I gotta stay cool.
When you're in your closet, come on.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm. I hope that answered your question, Mike.
Thanks. Super fun.
That gentleman with the two fingers?
He only had two?
Just like,
just checking.
Best, I guess, voice prank that you've ever pulled on anybody, whether it's professional or friends or...
Voice prank?
Yeah, like you ever called up somebody and...
There's a studio in LA called Cup of Tea Productions where I'm very, very good friends with them. And so I feel a lot looser when I'm in those sessions. I feel a little bit more relaxed. And while we were recording Tales of Zillia, it was a very comfortable session. And I didn't realize they recorded everything. But I was having so much fun. And when you're in flow, you're in the flow, and it's a funny project and you're being wacky, and I would go off and do really crazy wacky things, and like there is somewhere at Cup of Tea in their vault a recording of me playing Tipo with a French Canadian accent doing a rap. It was more a prank on myself because I was in the session for Conception 2 when they played it back to me. And I knew they had it on tape and I went, oh! So that was fun.
Me, the only thing that comes to mind, I really don't do a lot of like prank stuff with my voice, but me and my friends are coming back from a party. We had a designated DD and we're like, we want some food. So we go to a McDonald's, and for some reason, my other two drunk friends are just like, Chris, why don't you order it? Do it in a funny voice, and just like...
Oh, that's fun. I forget about stuff like that. That counts.
Yeah, and I'm just like...
I do that a lot.
All right. So I'm just like... I was just like, hey, man, I'm going to take, like, a Big Mac. It's a fries, my man. A lot of ketchup. You got that, man?
Did you want to have some hot? Okay, what did you want to drink?
Oh, you know, I want some root beer, you feel me?
Did you want that caffeinated or uncaffeinated?
Crazy, I caffeinated!
Okay.
And then we'll be up and they'll be like, here's your order. I'll be like, oh, thank you. And be like, the guy was just like, are you the same? Is this your order? Like, yep, that's our order.
I do that. I think you do it too, probably. Just in normal daily life, it just happens to be a part of who we are. We go into characters a lot. It drives my boyfriend crazy because there's a lot of type of accents that he does not enjoy. Like one of my favorites being Canadian. I just love the people from the South. They're just so polite. They're just so sweet. And I can talk in this accent all day. I just love it. He hates it. And I remember being at an airport going someplace and I was calling to tell my credit card people, like, please don't cancel my card. I'm going to Canada. And the guy on the phone, he started off, hi, how can I help you? Oh, fantastic. And the more we chatted, he was like, oh, this is great. Where are you going to go? Oh, you're going to have such a good time. I swear to you. And so I started doing it back to him. And we were having the greatest old chat. I just loved him. He was so sweet, so kind. You are just the nicest. And I got off the phone. I'm like, he was just the, don't talk about that. That happens to me a lot.
Yeah, I had a roommate who was an actor friend, and sometimes we would just talk, and what we would call bits, we would just go off in an improv session out of nowhere. We'd be talking, and it would lead off into this thing, which is like, we should write that down. We never did.
Never do.
But it would just naturally spawn, and just like, we delight ourselves as actors of just improvising, just like, that was really silly. That went further than we thought we would.
It is fun. Yeah.
What time do we have?
How are we doing?
We have 8 minutes.
8 minutes!
Oh, this guy has a question.
So, I heard that you were part of the High and Daisy for some for Comic Dub.
Why?
How was that?
It was...
Who did you play?
I have the shirt! I have the Yosuke Trial of the Deep Dragon High and Daisy shirt. I bought one for me and Yuri Lowenthal, so
Oh my
we have a picture of it on Tumblr. It's all over Tumblr.
My dear friend, her name Sapphire, goes by the name Strawberry Cream. It was a few years back now, at least, I feel like 4 or 5. And before I was doing any like major like professional voiceover work, she was just like, I want to do this comic dub, the High and Daisy comic. And was like,
let's do it.
And she was like, could you do some incidentals? I'm like, okay, blah, 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 you know, watch out. But then on the last chapter, she was just like, could you be Shadow Teddy? I was just like, all right. So I was just like, what was it? What's the word of the day? Mistake? Good enough!
I love it!
So it was just really
actually. He never told me this all day, he didn't tell me this. Thank you.
This guy, he knows. But yeah, no.
Secret man behind the curtain.
It was really fun, and hopefully she's been thinking about it. I don't want to quote her, but she's been heavily thinking of doing like a cucumber quest dub. It's High and Daisy's own ritual comic that she does.
Yay!
Very fun, very bright, very beautiful. I would highly recommend it. Cucumber quest.
You can
thank Jordan for telling me.
Jordan. Thank you, Jordan.
Thanks, Jordan.
Thank you, Jordan. Okay.
Since you mentioned Tipo a couple of minutes ago, this came to mind. Do you know who provides the voice of Elise? Because I have, for the life of me, have not been able to find out.
You will never be allowed to find out. I'm sorry. She doesn't want to be known. Some actors don't want to be known.
It's true.
Huh.
It's always a mystery. I would have to kill you and then myself.
And I don't want to die.
Any more questions?
Yeah.
Let's see if anybody has any questions.
Wait, is that Lisa?
Yes.
Hey!
Yeah.
Cosplay. Anyway, what's your question?
Are you guys going to the concert tomorrow?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
What are you thinking? Of course. I will be Chie. Wait, I am Chie.
The Chie with a jacket be like, I'm even more Chie now. Oh, which transformation can happen at any time. Two minutes!
Any burning questions?
Alexander.
So, persona question for, it's like Chie, do you ship Chie with anyone?
Yes. Who knows who I ship Chie with?
Is it Yosuke?
No.
Is it Shadow Chie?
No.
Yukiko!
Yes. When I first started performing Chie, the relationship with Yukiko, it wasn't a conscious thing that I decided beforehand. It was something that came from delivering the way the lines were written. Like, I really genuinely felt this tremendous love towards her. And then so for me, I kind of fell in love with Yukiko as Chie while I was recording the game. Now, that is not how Atlas sees it. So let's be clear for the record, although Atlas did cast me as Erica in the Catherine games, which is, you know, transgender awesomeness, so that is word. So they're not homophobic or anything, but that is just something. I think because she is, you know, so many people's waifu, they didn't want to sit down. For me, I really fell in love with Yukiko.
Honestly, my first waifu in Persona that I can't take away is Naoto.
Yeah.
Word. Follow Valerie Arm on Twitter. She's the current Naoto. Current. The other ones are secret. You will never know.
Why was she replaced?
The other actresses just stopped doing it.
Oh.
It's the Naoto curse.
Yeah, the Naoto curse. So they hired the voice director. They knew she wasn't going anywhere.
Voice actors who are just as mysterious as the actual character.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. That's good. You guys are so awesome for coming out to the voice actor panel. We're going to go through the autographs, I believe. And if you bring one item, we get to sign it for free, which is so cool about this convention. And we'll have another autograph signing tomorrow at 1:30, and then a panel, I think, at 3. And then again, repeat on Sunday at some point, but I don't know exactly on my brain.
How much do you charge?
How
much do you charge? How much do you charge?
For what item you get it for free?
For anything else?
Well, there'll be a